fractionalized notwithstanding, a major component that helps sustain an industry that is an economic multiplier and by all accounts here is responsible for the creation or the maintenance of 40,000 jobs statewide. Mr. Ferrallo talked about, and others talked about the 400 horse farms. They are in 39 counties of this state. You yourself observe the economic multiplier on a micro basis in the city of Saratoga. People parking cars, people selling water, people waiting on tables in restaurants. So the governor's responsibility is much broader than the mayor's in terms of the obligation that he has as it relates to the water industry. And so the legislature did a wise thing, but in taking this over and not allowing it to die. But we must face the reality that New York City OTB is insolvent. We have to face the reality that the business model is 20 to 30 years out of date. And the reason is because no money, no capital has been able to be accumulated in that business to reinvest in that business. So we're stuck with a model that started 40 plus years ago and is still the model today. No business sustains itself by having the same model in a world that has been turned upside down by technology. And so what we need to do is to relook at that model. We have to face the reality that we're going to have to change. We're going to have to sit and work with the union so that they feel that their members are getting a square deal, but they have to recognize that the workplace as they knew it will change. It will have to become more high-tech. It will have to become less labor-intensive. But those who have worked there should not be made scapegoats of this process. In the end, it's going to take a lot of money. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. New York City OTB owes, in arrearages, close to, or let me just round it up, or let me just use $100 million, it's a pretty good number, of past obligations, pension obligations to its statutory folks that we pay money out to. The horseman correctly said, for us to survive, we've had to take from Peter to pay Pauline. The truth is, we have moved our payment schedule to 120 days so that we are inflicting pain, but we're keeping the operations going until we can have a resolution that I think will sustain us. And that resolution will require a business model that will be able to pass muster in the investment marketplace, because the governor made it very, very clear to me that given the woes of the state and the national and global economies, that there will not be another cash bailout out of the expense budget of the state of New York. So that within OTB and within the process, we're going to have to find a way to make this a business that is fair to its employees and fair to the public. It's doable. The one thing I cannot discuss, and just as a matter of ethics, are my conversations with the governor and my specific recommendations to the governor. I hope you appreciate that part. But I can talk, as I have, in these very pointed generalities. We're going to have to find capital. We can, if we have a business model that works. And part of making that business model work will be an action of the New York State Legislature that will undo existing statute in some ways to allow this business to function as a business. If it does that, I think we can sustain it. I think we can cover our past and future obligation. I think we can increase its contribution back to the days when OTB was, in fact, a major asset rather than a liability. And I believe working together we'll get there. Thank you.
I don't really have any prepared remarks. I wanted to make myself available to the panel to answer any questions that you have or try to clarify any of the prior testimony if that can be helpful on those fronts. I will tell you that one of the questions that did come up from Senator Johnson was the split in New York City OTB between handle from out of state and in state. I will tell you that I checked with the office before I testified today, and I confirmed that the split is 60-40, not 75-25. It's about 60% of the handle comes from tracks outside of New York, and about 40% of the handle comes from tracks inside the state of New York, predominantly from Naira, which has a very big product in New York, and that accounts for about $300 to $335 million of our business. I can also address your OPEB questions. The OPEB number is primarily a number for both future and current retirees' health benefits. That makes up the lion's share of that particular number, and that number alone exceeds $200 million.
Let me say two things that I neglected to say. Number one, I don't know Mr. Feraldo well enough to engage in a fist fight. But let me say that if I were he, I would agree with his basic premise, which is that it is absurd for a New York State entity not to have a New York preference. And in the business plan that we will provide, we will take him up on his channel. The elimination of dark days and a hold harmless in exchange for New York priority. On the other hand, we hope to be able through electronically to run OTB 24/7 and thereby have product from around the world be available to customers in New York. There is no reason why any New York entity, including the people who raise the horses that compete here, should not benefit from worldwide racing. So I think that there is a relatively easy resolution to a heated but unnecessary confrontation. The other thing is, I want to thank the controller for his report, because it points out two things. Number one, excess of any kind in the public sector is not acceptable. It happens. It shouldn't. If there's one extra car, we should get rid of it. If there's one extra job that isn't justified, we should get rid of it. And to point out those things is not only appropriate, but necessary, because if you can't take the heat of the transparency of the public sector, you're in the wrong business. But the other thing that I want to thank the controller for is pointing out what Dino, in fact, undermined, which is you can get rid of all the cars, you can get rid of most of the managers, and you're still not going to solve the problem. This is a systemic structural problem that requires systemic structural solutions.
Senator Johnson has to depart, and I would like to give him an opportunity to ask any questions before he does.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll limit my questions. Thank you, Sir Kasem, for waiting to the very end. I guess they say the best for last, so to speak. But I have a couple questions that maybe it's trying to get my hands around what's going on. I know you reviewed the audit report, I know you reviewed the draft, I know you provided extensive comments to the final draft at the time. But try and help me understand something. And if we can, I want to refer to the report. On page 14, we talk about, and I'm focusing on the operating expenses of New York City OTB. And the pretty big ones, the three big ones, are salaries, fringe benefits, which doesn't include the retiree benefits, and rents. I'm trying to understand, on the second full paragraph, it begins the statement, the corporation's operating expenses increased by 21%. The second last sentence says salary expenses...
I think that says 2.1%.
I'm sorry, 2.1%, thank you. Salary expenses, $65.3 million in 2007-2008. Okay.
For the purposes of the stenographer, I have a copy of the audit with me, and I can provide it for you. To you.
Sure. It's on page 14, the second to last sentence, which begins, salary expenses, parentheses, $65.3 million in 2007-2008, close parentheses, have remained fairly constant since the 2000-2001 fiscal year, which parentheses, $65.4 million, close parentheses, as the total number of staff on the payroll has been reduced. What I'm trying to understand is, if you reduce the size of your staff, shouldn't your salaries be reduced as well? How come you're continuing to pay $65 million in salary.
Well, over the last 10 years, when I got to OTB, I think back in 2000, there were almost 2,000 employees. So when there's 2,000 employees in a particular location and making a particular amount of money, one of the ways that you can adjust for the rising cost of both expenses of the employees as well as other expenses is to adjust that particular headcount. So during that particular tenure, the headcount now stands, I believe, at 1,365. So over that period of time, almost 400 positions have been eliminated from OTB. In the management ranks alone, I guess it was back in 2003, we did a layoff of managers. When I got to OTB, I felt the management staff, frankly, was a little heavy, and we could do with less people. So we cut about 20 managers out of the corporation, and we tried then to adjust. We also made reductions in cars, numbers of locations, of branches over that period of time, so that the cumulative effect of lowering the headcount, removing costs out of the corporation, at the same time that other costs during that period of time are going up. Specifically, our contracts were negotiated by the city. So the city represents, you know, thousands and thousands of employees, and each year that there was a contract negotiation, there were costs that were added to salaries. We also have the effect of inflation. So that the overall cost for rents, for salaries, heat, light, to run a business just go up. And one of the ways that we were able to adjust it is by adjusting the headcount back down. And the $65 million effect that you see pretty flat over 8 years is really the cumulative effect of individual items, the cost of them going up, and then management adjusting the gross cost in total down so that they met. And that's how we were able to keep the salaries basically flat. You will not see that trend as it relates to pension costs, just like the state. You will not see that trend as it relates to medical costs, just like the state and the city. Some of those costs did go up. And so when the total cost went up, it was not in the salaries, but it was in the benefit costs, the fringe. Rents have also gone up during that same period of time. They stand at about $20
million. I understand that, but...
Does that answer your question about the $65
million? Well, not really, because if you went from 2,000 employees to 1,365 employees,
right,
you still your salary amount went from $65.3 million to $65.4 million. If you lose an employee, I would think you would lose the corresponding salary, unless you're telling me that you raised salaries for when you lower the headcount, you raise the salaries for those who remain.
If I didn't say it clear enough, I do apologize, but I thought I did say that during that period of time, there were negotiations that took place. Both union and management employees got raises during that particular period of time. Those contracts were negotiated by the city with some of the unions that you heard testify. But I will tell you, I'm not saying that was the wrong thing to happen. Those same employees worked very hard for the corporation, and during that tenure, New York City OTB's handle has gone to record levels. Handle was as much as $1 billion and $70 million. That came primarily from the work of those particular employees. So they were able to drive the handle back up with management. And so there were increases to the salaries of those employees during that period of time. That was not negotiated by OTB, it was negotiated by the city.
Senator,
and the cost went up.
You're making a very good point, which is that there is a structural problem, that the structure of New York City OTB just simply has, at this point, worked against it. New York City OTB effectively was a city agency for virtually its entire life. The collective bargaining settlements and the salary scales of New York City OTB were effectively set by the city.
Right. I mean, that's...
New York City OTB was part of the collective bargaining unit, the entire coalition bargaining that New York City had. So whatever salaries all city employees got, OTB people got, both on the management as well as on the labor side. So it's conundrum. I mean, the fact of the matter
you is... You don't control your collective bargaining negotiations. It was controlled by Mayor Bloomberg. Right?
It was, and now the state...
And now the state. But,
you know, and
but there hasn't been... I'm sorry to cut you off, but there hasn't been negotiations for 2 years.
Representatives were saying, hey, you know...
Right.
You know, we fell between the cracks. You guys owe us, and morally, ethically, I mean, they have a pretty good argument to be made for was last I heard it. The fact of the matter is that you're stuck in a model, as are the employees, I might add, where you sit behind the cage and you wait for people to come in. I mean, you know, horse racing is called the sport of kings. You know, at OTB, you know, betting was the sport of paupers.
But the problem...
The demographics here are very bad.
Oh, sure.
You know, talk to 55 plus. In France, 52% of the wagering is done by women. You know, correctly pointed that out as a target of opportunity. You know, very many women go into New York City OTB parlor. The environment is a hostile environment. The fact is they haven't been able to capitalize any upgrades to the facilities forever because of the way it's structured. So a lot of this is broken, and I believe you should, and all of us should, do a retrospective on why it shouldn't happen. But there are three problems here. Number one, we owe, retroactively, about $100 million. Number two, we have to keep an operation going. Even if you're going to transition to a new model, you have to get from here to there. By that I mean, you cannot sacrifice the bulk of $1 billion of revenue you get, 80% of which, $800 million of which, is passed back to the wagerer. So you're talking about a pool of about $200 million. The industry in New York City OTB's insolvency in this year, 09, we're probably going to lose $20-25 million, but the industry will get $100 million, and the local governments will get $100 million. So you can change the formula. If you change the formula, you might be able to eke out a better cash flow, but you're not going to sustain it over time with an increase in cost. And then there's the third cost, and that is the cost of rebuilding or recapitalizing an outmoded business. And again, to shut it down, who comes up with the $600 million? I think it's a bad choice. It's always the choice in the public sector. You know, as long as you have benefits, as long as you have constitutionally committed pensions, somebody, if you stop it, there's still a run out that's going to go out over a long period of time. This is a solvable problem, but everybody's going to have to get together to solve it.
My only other question is just regarding the telephone betting center.
Yes.
According to the report, you put the issue on the back burner, or according to the audit report on page 23, the relevant sentence is the last one. When we, and that's the audit group from the comptroller's office, discussed this issue with corporation officials, they stated that they had put this issue on the back burner while they were developing their closure plan. Where are we with respect to the telephone betting center?
Well, the things that will benefit the telephone betting center primarily are better technology. So the money really hasn't been available to make that investment. If the money became available to make that investment, for example, one of them was a Cisco switch for a few hundred thousand dollars. There was very little capital that's been available over the last couple of years to make any of those kinds of investments. In fact, most of the capital during the transition from a city entity to a state entity got used for operations.
How much is it?
That's one example.
What's the total cost for the telephone betting center for capital, the capital purposes or capital needs?
I'd have to get back to you on that exact number, but I certainly can get it for you. But the telephone betting center has already been built. It exists at 1501. It was built approximately 10 years ago, and it employs a couple of the 100 people that are listed at 1501 work in that account wagering area on telephone betting. But I have to get back to you on what the capital infusion has been. I can say that I believe it's been very small, and it, in fact, has been underfunded for the last few years.
Okay, if you can get us that information, that'd
absolutely
be great. Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you, and I want to thank you for conducting this very important hearing. I think it was extremely informative. I think we have a very large task ahead of us, but I think one that we can certainly undertake.
Thank you very much, Craig, for coming down, Senator Johnson.
Senator Johnson, I've made this offer to other senators. This can be the beginning of the dialogue. If there are any other questions that you have, I or my staff are more than happy to come out and meet with you.
Terrific. Thank you very much.
Just a few questions, Mr. Casey. As we heard earlier, the Comptroller's Office is looking to do a detailed audit on several areas, but it just did a broad audit. Is OTB amenable to having a detailed audit on the leases, salaries, in all other areas?
As chairman, I say we welcome it, but we welcome it. Hopefully it'll be an ex post facto memoriam to a business that will have changed by the time the audit gets done. And the audit that was given now has some use, but it's 18 months old. A full field audit will take 2 years. If we don't rebuild, restructure, recapitalize between now and then, as I say, it'll be an epitaph.
Senator, at New York City OTB, we first had the city come through. The Boston Consulting Group, you heard about that report. They were in our offices for 7 months. My staff devoted thousands of hours of time reviewing every rock and looking at every opportunity that OTB had. Controller Thompson, the city controller, came through and did an audit of OTB and has made some public statements about our business. The state controller has come through. We have our own internal auditors that do audits every particular year. There were a lot of audits, and it's standing orders for us to cooperate fully. My background, as you know, before I entered the business of OTB, was that as an inspector general myself. So I believe in transparency, and I believe when the controller or any auditor walks through the door, you tell him more information than they ask for. And that will continue to be our policy no matter who's on our board, but as long as I'm the CEO.
Great, thank you. I just wanted to be on record with that. I just want to look at certain areas, because I know I heard several times today that the problems that we experience with OTB, even if we fix the problems of cars and fix the problems of fringe benefits, et cetera, that it's not going to solve the problem. But we are dealing with a time where the taxpayers' perception is reality. And when we're asking the taxpayers to tighten their belts, to give back, it sends the wrong message. When we are allowing even those things that will not turn around a particular industry or a particular corporation, we need to give the very clear perception that we are doing all we can to save taxpayers' money, that we all agree that this is taxpayers' money that we're spending.
Ultimately, yes. Senator, I can't agree with you more. And I mean, we can talk about this in the very narrow context of off-track betting, but nationally, we are seeing a raging debate on healthcare around something called the public option. And that whole debate is around the perception of a lot of the public that government is a managerial catastrophe. And that's why President Obama is having the problem he has selling a public option on healthcare. So your point is right on target. Government has an obligation not just to perform well, but to convince the public that it is performing well, because it adversely affects public policy when the public thinks that its public servants are a bunch of bozos or crooks. So you're right. There's no ifs, ands, or buts.
With that in mind, your current headquarters is located in, the Times Square area. Okay, is it cost-effective? Why not use a Naira RAND facility, a user facility, and it's out of horse track somewhere that is not as expensive? I believe Times Square is some of the most costly real estate we have.
Times Square is pretty expensive. Some of the office rents have exceeded $65 a foot, and that's exactly why about 2.5 years ago we sought to sort of renegotiate that particular deal. And we changed our lease a few years ago and shed. I mentioned before we did some management cuts within 1501. We had also, through attrition, reduced the rest of the headcount. So once those things took place, we shrunk into the space that we have at 1501 and got rid of a floor, saving about $1 million every year. So for the last, actually it's about 3 years, we've saved about $1 million off of our expenses by shrinking our footprint at 1501. We also have some real estate experts that have looked at whether or not we could move out of 1501. When we negotiated that deal, we negotiated a price per square foot of about $28 a square foot when the market was 65. So you can't completely look at it by just saying you're in Times Square and will it be less expensive to go someplace else. Basically, if we had the ability to move to rent where we were rent-free or we're paying $10 or $15 a foot, we probably could achieve some cost savings. But the cost of a move and then the cost of a build-out of new space so far has appeared to be sort of cost neutral in moving out of 1501. But as the market changes, and if we got an opportunity to move into space at very low cost, or in the alternative, we were able to change the business model on how we operate and further reduce staff, then it would make sense probably to move. So the idea of moving is something that we constantly look at, and we review it all the time. And if those opportunities presented itself, I can tell you that we would certainly take advantage of it. But it is a cost item that over the years we have reduced to, as I said before, we're saving about $1 million a year on just the changes that we made on the lease at 1501.
The 1501, how many floors do we have at 1501?
It's about 2.5 floors. There was once 3.5, and so now it's 2.5.
Oh, and the cost you gave at, you said $28 a square foot?
I believe it was at 29, and it goes up to, there's an escalation in the coming year of a couple of dollars a foot.
What is that in comparison to other boroughs? Are we dealing with $28, $29 a square foot?
I mean, frankly, one of the places that we've looked really hard at, and we've looked about moving our call center there, was Long Island City.
Mm-hmm.
Long Island City had some banks and financial institutions that, after the meltdown, they vacated some call center space. So we looked at what it would be to kind of move some of our operation over to Long Island City. But they, again, were right around that price point of like $20. And then when you back in all the costs to move and the capital build out, it doesn't save you money. It's not a bullet that, you know, saves the day.
What about some of our other properties that we lease?
Let me address that. In the plan that we would have going forward, Senator, everything's up. Everything's on the table, or will be on the table. If you start with the premise that the brick-and-mortar model is passé, I think it leads to some invariable conclusions that you're going to be looking for different kinds of structure. If you look at the French model, for example, they have a much higher, considerably higher per capita wagering, and they essentially run out of the parlors are bistros and bars and other places where people gather. So a conversion from brick and mortar to technology is an evolution that is inevitable. How we get there is important. As far as the headquarters is concerned, the moving of technology and call centers, which again is technology, is a complicated and expensive thing to do. So to rebuild a whole new enterprise when you really don't know what your long-term fate is and you really don't have the capital to do it, and frankly, given all the uncertainty around OTB at the moment, until there is certainty, who would take your credit? Who's going to be behind you? I don't think the city or the state want to take on the responsibility of long-term obligations here. So it'll be part of a plan that we'll address when we have to present a holistic plan, which I'm committed to you to do very soon. We run out of money by the end of the year, Mr. Chairman. Around the end of the year, the rubber really hits the road, and either we'll have a solution or you'll have a very big problem.
One of my concerns, and probably at the heart of the hearing, is that we must move away from the model of bailouts, and we must move in the direction of redefining our industries so that they can be state-of-the-art industries. And so not only do we have to look at and examine how do we move from here, but we can't, in that move, we can't move baggage that brought us here in the first place.
Yes, and part of the baggage, as we said, goes to the issue of what I call the original sin. You have a fractionated industry. You see it in some of the testimony. You see good people fighting with each other because they're all fighting for a piece of the same rock. There has to be a better way to do this. I mean, Mr. Feraldo represents a constituency that is an important constituency in the state. You know, you saw it with your own eyes. I have a home in Hudson, New York, in Columbia County. There are a number of horse farms in Columbia County. That's not just a plaything for the rich. Those are jobs for high school students. That's jobs for local folks who need those jobs. So, I mean, this is, you know, there are 40,000 jobs, people say, that are directly associated with this industry. You know, what makes me unique is that I'm not one of those 40,000 jobs. I'm doing this pro bono. I have a completely neutral view. I don't have a clouded view of this. I'm looking at this as a businessman who is, I hope, sensitive to public policy issues, because I've spent half my career in the public sector. New York City OTB is a statewide resource and asset that must be preserved because it helps sustain a statewide industry. My assignment is limited to New York City OTB, but beyond that, you folks have to figure out how to get this fractionalized structure better consolidated, such that people are rowing in the same direction. A lot of the problems here are because people are shooting in. Someone once described the Democratic Party as a group of folks who, when they circled the wagons, they shot in. I think that is a better description of what I now have seen from racing.
I think it's commendable that your contribution, I think your resume speaks volume of the assets that the governor is going to obtain by having you look at this problem overall. I think that was one of the mistakes we've made in the past, and we applaud your contribution. And the last thing we needed was another salary.
The real question is, will you love me tomorrow?
I just want to go back for a moment. Part of the report that came out of the comptroller's office, we had a 35.3 increase in fringe benefits. Help me understand that. What is that fringe benefits based on health care, things like that? What is that about? What is the increase?
I believe 90% of the number is health care costs.
Okay.
And pensions.
Mm-hmm. Can you define fringe benefits for me?
Fringe benefits make up all of the costs for personnel beyond the salary and wage portion that's paid to an employee. So any of the benefits that they get, such as their accrued leave balances, vacation time, any of the medical costs they get, eyeglasses, dental, the health care costs that we offer to all of our employees, both management and union.
Now, why would we have such a substantial 35.3? Is that a normal trend in increasing?
That's the same trend that if you go back at the time before OTB was a state agency, I can tell you that it matched the trend in the city, because those same fringe benefits were negotiated at the bargaining table with the rest of the package of salary and wages. The managers have a package of quote-unquote fringe benefits that are a little bit different than the union employees. They get paid through a general welfare fund, and they have many of the same options that the management have, but I believe on the dental and eyeglass piece, that's paid for in their actual policy, and it's a rider on the management policy. But it's just basic health care. Employees pay a portion of it, so different plans, there are different contributions.
For a moment, just talk about these famous vehicles that everybody's talking about. How many vehicles are we talking about?
Well, right now, I think they're at 74 or 75.
74, and they go to who?
For the most part, the vehicles are vans. We have, as you know, a network that spans the five boroughs. We have branches that are all over the city in the five boroughs. One of the things we talked about today was the technology. The branches still rely on a lot of what I'll call sort of analog supplies. In other words, the profile sheets, the newspapers, they have to be delivered to those branches every day. So there's a fleet of vehicles that deliver stuff to the branches. There's another fleet of vehicles, mostly vans and trucks, that are tasked to clean the branches. Other vehicles are used. We're required to, under our contracts, to maintain all of our betting equipment. So we have our own internal technical staff, and that technical staff also have vehicles that go out and service the betting equipment. It's very imperative. Every time we have a particular machine that is down for more than an hour or two, we lose revenue. So it's important to us to immediately be able to fix our equipment and make that available, because it directly relates to our revenue. We also have, and you may be more familiar with this than some others, a special patrolman, basically some people consider it an internal police force, but my history in law enforcement, I only call the NYPD police, but they are internal security to OTB that secure all of our branches, and they have a number of vehicles to get to all the branches, and they're tasked with a patrol of a lot of our facilities. Most of the people that manage those particular kinds of departments also have vehicles available to them.
Okay, separate for me the vehicles that are used for deliveries, maintaining the equipment, and help me understand what are our number of vehicles that are used for managerial personnel. So separate the two. I understand we need vehicles.
Right now, I believe the number is somewhere between 15 to 18 vehicles that are driven by managerial employees. So those are employees that are not in a union. That doesn't mean that they are, you know, a vice president. It just means that they're in a capacity of management. So they are not represented by a particular union of our employees. And so, for example, the person who heads up facilities has a vehicle to go check on his staff. He has a vehicle. Most of our departments have at least one vehicle that's available to them, especially our departments that are connected to our field operation.
I'm a big believer in, you know, we have the best transportation system on the globe.
Yep.
You know, I'm a proud card carrying Metro card.
Metro card? So, I think I have one too.
Okay. So I get sort of, I take it personal when city employees in non-emergency situations are allocated vehicles. It may seem like a small thing, but the best way to make sure our public transportation system is the best is for those of us who are in decision-making positions to go side by side with the average commuter.
Well, I can tell you, Senator, that when I got to OTB, there were, you've quoted some numbers in the patrols audit, and I looked at a discrete period of time where I think there were 80-some-odd vehicles. When I got to OTB, there were more than 100 vehicles. I think it was 105 or 108 vehicles. And so between 2003 and the present, we have steadily reduced that fleet of vehicles. When the initial results of Tom DiNapoli's audit was presented to me by lower level staff, I asked my own staff, I said, well, they said that there's more vehicles here. When was the last time you checked and reviewed which ones we absolutely need? And they said, well, probably about a year and a half ago. And they said, we have less vehicles now than we did a year and a half ago. I said, well, can't we have less? And so when before the audit was even over, I think it was even before the official first draft of the audit, we had reduced that fleet by 15%, and we went out of our way to basically agree with that particular position. Since that time, we have tried to change some of the policies to review the vehicle use, and I anticipate that there will be less vehicles used in the future, not more. However, the caveat is that, you know, where there is a need to be able to get to branches and be able to secure branches and be able to bring equipment to branches and have equipment available, there will always be a need as long as our infrastructure spans the whole city to be able to use vehicles to support that. But I can commit to you that, you know, as lean as we can try to be on that in the future, we will endeavor to do that.
What are some of the other areas that you believe we can become lean, using your term?
Well, you know, we have about 12 less branches since I'm president. And some of those decisions, I think, were the correct ones, and unfortunately some of them weren't. Because some of the branches that we lost, where the handle does not transfer over to the other infrastructure, ends up being a net loser for everybody. But, you know, to some degree, we have to be very careful to be able to make an investment in the future that it will not just eliminate or change infrastructure and eliminate revenue. We have to create opportunities to grow that pie. We have not had that opportunity over the last few years. We desperately need an ability to invest in the business. And some of that investment, as you heard about today, will be technology. With technology, you not only get the ability to grow the handle, but sometimes you get a more efficient operation. And so when I see us becoming more lean, I think technology will allow us a more efficient channel to grow revenue.
Mr. Chairman, that's a very good point. You heard testimony today from Dino about how effective and how efficient or now productive or profitable, is super senators. There is one in New Jersey that is quite extraordinary. Those are very expensive to build out. The question is, what is the appropriate mix between accessible opportunities to wager in a neighborhood and central locations that will attract large numbers of people? The two important points about the Nassau and New Jersey situations are that they have parking, their constituents are more mobile in that regard, and people go to them via, mostly by automobile. In New York City, if you had a super parlor, where would you put it? You put it in Times Square, more expensive rent, very expensive building, very expensive by the square foot. And if you had that, what would you give up by not having neighborhood outlets? So it's a balance. A lot of this is being modeled out. But it's very hard to do that because there really aren't very many analogous situations to the density and the complexity of the issues in New York City. But there is no question that the current brick-and-mortar model doesn't work. And there's no question that a 55-plus demographic is not the demographic that you want. But the things that we know about the internet is that there are no bookmakers. You know, it doesn't respect geography, it's underneath it. And so there are a lot of challenges here, and there are a lot of balances. I can commit to you that we won't present a plan that will have one extra car that does not have a business purpose. Now, if it ended up that way, it's a mistake, and we correct it. We don't believe in cars as a fringe benefit. If it doesn't have a big, if it doesn't have a business purpose, it will not do. And that's my commitment, and I know the rest of the board feels exactly the same. We're going to have a lean, lean operation. We recognize that every dollar spent on administration is a dollar less that goes either directly to the public or to institutions that the legislature, in its wisdom, believes is necessary to subsidize because that has a multiplier effect and a benefit to the public. So I for one, can assure you that we understand our responsibility here, and we will be vigilant both in how we design this enterprise and ultimately in terms of how it is managed.
So what's important to me, and I thank you for those comments, is that I live by a phrase, you have to inspect what you expect.
Yeah.
And it's great to have new procedures, new policies in place. How are we going to inspect what we expect so that we don't have to worry about an industry failing at this magnitude?
Well, I mean, I think you should use, you know, I think that the standard you should use for an organization like OTB, which is a distinct entity, different than a health or human services enterprise, is the standard measures that are used for a business. And you should look at it like a venture capitalist or a hedge fund operator, and you should say, are the returns commensurate with the investment? Am I putting, based on the amount of money that I'm investing in this enterprise, am I getting a sufficient yield? And they want, a venture capitalist or a businessman wants to get a significant return. And in this case, that return drops to the public's bottom line. That's the measures you use. You should use standard business kinds of assessments. This is not a health and human service enterprise. This is not where the public decides it wants to invest money in supporting a park or a wetland. This is a business. It subsidizes other businesses, but the measure should be a business measure. And when we present a plan, it should be measured based on whether or not it's a successful business. We're giving you something that, as they say, pencils out and gives a sufficient return. You know, there are very few reasons why the public or public enterprises should run operations like wagering. It's a very serious and debatable question. If it's in it, it better produce for the public. If it doesn't, it has no right to be. That's clear.
Can we talk about technology for a moment?
Sure.
Our websites. One, I want to talk about transferring money, winnings, into our bank accounts or into savings accounts. Is that something that's on the drawing board, something in the plan of using technology to have those type of transfers?
We're looking at all of those issues, yes.
Mm-hmm. When you say, help me understand that, when you say you're looking at...
What you just asked me specifically, we are looking at technology that would allow folks to be able to move money in and out of their accounts as quickly as possible.
You said you were in Saratoga, you're at the Crypto.
Yes. Often.
If anyone who goes to a track knows there's a machine. You walk into a virtually any track, harness or thoroughbred. You walk into a track, you go over to a window, you get a prepaid card, you sit down, you swipe the card, boom, you get a screen. On that screen, you have your choice, Lucky Louie in the third, bang, bang. If you win, it's credited to your card. At the end of the day, you take the card and you go to the window. There are no windows now other than OTB. In order to get transfer, which is probably a good thing, from if you go to a technology that allows you to swipe a prepaid card, bet on a race, hopefully a New York prep preferred race, or a race that will benefit everybody in New York 24/7, and your winnings are credited to that card, you have to have a place to cash out. Either a direct deposit to your account, which, based on the complexities of the banking system, would take 3 days to go back to your debit card, or another vehicle that would allow for an instantaneous transfer so that you could then use your card as a debit card and take it out of any ATM machine in existence. That would require changes in the banking system. And might create some, it might also require some creative structuring that also might require legislation. But your point is well taken. There is a fine line, though, between the law, which says no credit can be extended directly for wager. That is a correct law. But we now have a new kind of deposit, which is a debit, a card, which is a debit card, where you're only extracting money that you have already put in that card.
Right.
And so, yes, I think that we have to look at the banking laws to make that process efficient. Remember, an OTB parlay does four things. Place your bet, you cash your bet, your winnings, you watch the race, and you socialize with friends. Those are four components, and they're local. They're in your neighborhood. So, that convenience factor is not to be ignored. On the other hand, there can be entertainment centers that can attract you. So you're balancing it. But a lot of our stuff is technologically out of date because technology exists to do the things, and in some instances, our laws are out of date. There's no reason why we shouldn't be able to access debit accounts, and that's one of the changes we are going to recommend.
That's my concern. When you say they're out of date, because our competitors are already using this form of technology. How do we catch up to our competitors if we're going to stay on the edge and lead the pack and not follow the pack?
We're going to have to capitalize it. And we're going to have to come to you for the legislative changes that are necessary for it. And it's no secret that we've had conversations with the representatives of the men and women who work for OTB. These folks have traditionally worked under a very, very rigid civil service structure. Their jobs are classified almost in Henry Ford type assembly line fashion. You're a riveter. And the world is going to require a lot more broadband. So in order for us to get from here to there, we're going to have to talk about certain kinds of changes in the civil service law. If we're going to, we're going to have to ask for changes in the banking law. And those are the kinds of things that have to be part of a clearly articulated plan. Nobody can ask the legislature or the industry to accept, you know, a pig in a poke. We're going to have to ask people to look at a plan to make assessments as to whether or not that makes sense, and we'll present it to you. You're right. We are behind the curve. It's a tragedy. New York State was the first OTB. We screwed it up by fractionalizing the industry. We have everybody fighting with each other as opposed to working in a harmonious way. If, you know, at some point after I've, you know, done what I'm supposed to do here, you know, you have to look at how you can start to pull the wagering dollar together in such a way that it doesn't compete with itself. You know, even now, you know, the truth of the matter is that racing, the industry itself is challenged, whether it's because OTB was set up the way it is a piece of it, but not the whole story. The demographic for the tracks are old. The tracks themselves are undercapitalized. People don't want to go there. Now they're being attracted by video lottery run by the lottery. And, you know, racing has become a casino. We have to look at the whole panoply of those issues. We as a government have to look at the panoply of all of those issues. The last thing we want is a continuation of this fractured approach to wagering. We need to have a unified policy. We have to decide what we want to do. And then when we do it, we have to make sure it is works and that there aren't ways to die. If we create a system that is separate and from, say, the lottery, if we're going to go to prepaid cards to use electronic machines, and we end up in a system where we have to create our own network, while the lottery has its own network out there to sell prepaid cards, you ought to take us and spank us or shoot us. In my case, please, fire me. But the point I'm making is duplication that costs the taxpayers a lot of money. Fractionalization, of course, is worse than an extra cost.
No, so true, so true. Speaking of duplication, do you believe it's imperative for us to share our resources? That was a question that I mentioned earlier. Do you foresee sharing resources, sharing those parts of the industry that we see duplications?
I think there are a lot of opportunities that are out there to, you know, share some services, at least among some of the OTBs. And if I didn't say it before in this testimony, I think at the end of the day, we have to stop competing with racetracks. So, you know, that, I guess I've used the word, is ludicrous about the law and still exists. There is no way when we're done that we should be competing with our own tracks inside of New York. And I think that absolutely, let's just apply logic. There is absolutely could be efficiencies in some shared services, and those are things that should get explored. But what's of paramount importance is to fix New York City OTB, which represents half of the handle and the revenue in the state off track. We've got to get that fixed. At the same time, it doesn't mean we don't look at those other issues. We absolutely will and should continue to do, but we have some very acute issues coming down the pike for New York City OTB that relate to our cash. And we're going to need to do things that relate to New York City OTB, quite frankly, I believe, first and foremost. But absolutely, part of that solution, a little bit over the midterm, not the long term, but the midterm, is some shared services. I, frankly, have talked about this publicly before the Senate. I think that we should have a common tote vendor,
yeah,
which is a technology.
We spent $15 million amongst the OTBs, roughly, and from an IRA, maybe it's as much as $15 to $20 million. We figured out about roughly $20 million. Guess what? They all produce the same number.
So,
which, by the way, is a good thing, because if you didn't have a good thing, if you had different numbers, you'd have arbitrage, but which you don't want. But the point is, $15 million, you can produce the same number for what, Greg? Do you know?
Have we looked at
some... That money is taken out of the public's purse.
Have we looked at some of the other areas, such as the internet, you know, phone lines? Have we looked at some of the other areas? And what type of timetable are we talking about consolidating, sharing some of our services?
Senator, I spent 2 years ago almost 11 months trying to convince every OTB in the state to have a single internet platform. And the result of that is the result that you heard Dino testify to. We have three platforms. Frankly, I believe we should have one. The platform that we have at OTB, and I helped draft the internet law in New York State, and I supported it. I tried to be to bring everybody together. And what happens sometimes in government is good intentions don't always have results. And we have three platforms. I believe in the future we can have one. But the first hurdle really has to be the back-end technology. That tote vendor and that tote technology has to be able to cooperate. And so I think that it makes sense from a business standpoint and an operational standpoint for that to happen first. That will allow portability, that will allow a lot of other benefits as well as some efficiencies.
Mr. Chairman, the truth of the matter is that the driver for that, in all honesty, has to come from the legislature and from the executive branch. The fact is, and from the executive branch, we cannot mandate what other independent entities do. We actually, in our insolvency, don't even have a bully pulpit to make the argument. Now, we will hopefully, in a plan, show where savings can and should occur, but we cannot lead the charge beyond the example that we're going to show in our resurrection on how we think it should be done. But as to issues of consolidation either of services or of enterprises, aside from it being beyond my mandate, I wouldn't get there because I wouldn't even venture to get into that arena, even if it wasn't, because that's known as the big muddy, and I wouldn't get out of there and be able to focus on what we need to do, which is to save this company. By the end of the year, we need to have a plan that can be implemented, or we run out of cash, and Mr. Corrado might run out of head, because he's not going to be getting a check. So there is an urgency to what we do. Beyond that, I strongly recommend that those in policy positions look at the questions that you're asking. And as chairman of the committee, I am positive, because you ask the question, you know the issue, that you will be leading this charge, because it has to be done, and you're in the place to do it.
And New York City OTB is in support of that? Okay, and I think that, we're at the point of the triage system, where we have to deal with those fatal issues, but the reality is we got to multitask. We don't have the luxury of focusing on one specific task at a time, because even if we deal with the fatal issue, we still got other issues that are present. So multitasking is one of them. The website. Just talk to me for a moment about the website. What is why is it so austere? What do we want to do with it? We have no streamlined video like some of the competitors. What's the goal for the website? That's the window of some of the new industry that we're talking about. Are there any plans with the website?
Yeah, I mean, New York City OTB's website was recently upgraded and should get upgraded again. We do not show video streaming on a particular website, and it's our hope to be able to add that. I will tell you that on that particular topic, one of the contracts, due to our financial circumstances, when OTB went into its sort of mode of closing down and then being transferred to the state, there was a bid to award a streaming contractor that was canceled. It was one of the things that didn't happen. And quite frankly, it's going to take money to pay that vendor to be able to have streaming video on that particular website, as well as permission probably from some tracks in the state that we compete with. From the customer standpoint, and from the fan standpoint, and from a revenue standpoint, we need to find a way to get there.
So true.
I mean, we can be a 24-hour business with it.
So talk to me about a moment about that, the 24-hour business. You alluded to that earlier.
I did. I mean, there is, let's call it product, that goes around the world. Again, I hasten to say that New York races should be given priority, but at 3 a.m., if you're a traveling salesperson and you're in a hotel room, we think the hotel room should go up and do other entertainment than pornography. If you'd like to go nose to nose. and offer racing. There are races, there are there's product that goes from New Zealand all around the globe, 24/7. That product in today's world is accessible, totally accessible. There's no reason for OTB to sleep. It can constantly be out there providing product. And I asked Mr. Ferrando, if we don't have a race somewhere, certainly not in New York City, somewhere in the world, we should do what the Brits would do and do virtual races, which we believe is constitutional as long as it's races. So the point is, there can be a 24-hour product. It could be available through that internet in hotel rooms, in people's homes, anywhere.
And if you have the right channel and the right business plan and the right business model, more revenue will flow through not only to the racing industry, to breeders, but to taxpayers.
That's right.
Because you just raised the point, what are we doing to see what are the best practices? Where is the industry globally going? Is there an arm of our operation that is looking to see, number one, what's the best practices in technology? What's the best practices?
I hear they have a great one in Paris, but we're afraid to send anybody over there. You think cars would stir up a hornet?
But are we looking at what is the direction of the industry and what are others doing that have learned from us? Because it's obvious if we were the first OTB, others learned from us.
Yes.
What are others doing that we can learn from them?
I think we've talked about some of them already today. I think that you have to take a look at the physical infrastructure and do these storefronts work for the future. I frankly think that our storefront locations, although the people that work there work very, very hard under sometimes not the best circumstances, but they've become a bar to us growing the rest of our business. I mean, frankly, there are people that I talk to that are afraid to go into some of the OTBs. For somebody who has a responsibility both to the public and to the corporation and to my employees, that appalls me. But we don't have the money to change it. So it all drives back to having the right business model and the right plan to be able to invest in the business for the future. And so you need to be able to have something that works to be able to make those kinds of investments. OTB has never been able to retain earnings. So you may have a business that can't even retain earnings, it can't invest in itself. How does it change itself? How does it adapt to the marketplace? It doesn't have an opportunity to do that. I think Dino said, give me an opportunity with ADWs. We could have, you're right, a one-hour conversation on ADWs. But the reality is that you don't have a level playing field. You have entities that are out there that are operating, that are not paying taxes, that are not following the rules. I can't tell you how much handle they're taking because they're not transparent. OTB's transparent.
But we should have the resources to compete with them in terms of technology.
Yes.
And we have to. And I think it's imperative that we find a way.
Well, we can't take it out of the public treasury. So right. We have to have a way to finance it, candidly. And the only way we're going to have a way to finance it is if we have a business plan that a business plan that structures us in a way that will allow whatever kind of investor we can find, whether it's a bond investor or some other kinds of investors. Right now, we are out of bounds. There's no one out there, unless we restructure it, that would invest a dime, unless, of course, they're crazy.
Do you have a tentative date on when your plan will be revealed?
Well, I'm going to work backwards. Backwards is, by the end of the year, we have to have a plan that's ready to go.
Senator, this is maybe us drawing a box for ourselves, but there, you know, with all of this discussion over the last few years, there has not been a single taxpayer dollar that has been spent on OTB. All of the money that has come to support OTBs all over the state have come from the revenue that it generates. When we say that we're going to run out of cash, that means that that's where we draw the line. I can tell you, I've said it to you publicly before, I've said it to you privately, I don't want to ever be here when a public dollar gets spent. And we have an opportunity to fix it, but we have to fix it now. And so no dollars ever get spent, and that we reverse what's going on, and that we contribute to the public.
And I agree, and I think that...
In its insolvency, New York City OTB this year contributed $100 million to the designated entities that the state has designated. However, we are depriving the public of dollars that they could get.
I think that...
This is an opportunity cost here is significant.
I think that it's, you know, you mentioned earlier several times in your conversation, you know, we may be moving away from brick and mortar, we may be including new technology, which is important. But as the chair of this committee, what's important to me is to protect the employees. Any system that's void of protecting and leaving our employees intact is a system that I cannot support. It's about the everyday 9-to-5 person that's participating. And so I hope whatever plan that is unveiled by the governor in office, it includes a way of ensuring those long, hard benefits that those employees fought for and deserve. And we can make sure that we move in a direction where our employees are part of the movement that we're going to make. And I'm calling on you, as the head of OTB. I become dismayed when we cannot look inside an institution that has been around for several decades in our growth, in our transformation. We're doing things in a manner that should be done differently. And we need to find, all of us, it's calling all of government to find where our waste lies. And where that waste lies, we need to trim it. Because in order to go to the taxpayers and explain the importance of this institution, we have to also show that we're putting our best foot forward to make sure that we do away with whatever waste is in place.
I commit to you that any plan we submit will be fair and equitable for the employees. On the other hand, the employees themselves, I believe, recognize that the new OTB will not be like the old OTB, that their work environment hopefully will be better, but it will be smaller, hopefully generate more revenue, but it will be smaller, it will be different. And so the only way to achieve it, frankly, is to work together. And I believe that we will work in ways where the OTB and its employees can find a path that will work for both.
Thank you.
Our employees are our partners, Senator, and they'll continue to be.
Thank you very much. I think we have one last testimony from the public. Mr. Bowman. No, I'm sorry, Mr. Kendrick.
My name is Arthur Kindred, K-I-N-D-R-E-D. Mr. Chairman, if I was Mr. Bowman, I'd be down in Bermuda someplace today. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to come and make a statement before your committee regarding the racing and game activity in the state of New York. I'm vice president of E.G. Bowman Company. E.G. Bowman Company is the largest African-American-owned insurance brokerage firm. We have three products, by and large. We are property casualty-driven. We provide services in risk management and also, obviously, loss control and safety management. The company is almost 100 years old. For the record, I've given one of your staff members a copy of this history to some extent. I have one question, and before I make that, ask that question, I was sitting listening to the different views how to fix a broken system, and it reminded me of the history of New York State after the Civil War. There were 13 African-American slaves who were jockeys. New York State was one of the states that allowed them to come in and race. And after the Civil War, obviously, they were pushed out. You have very few jockeys in the system around the world. New York State, I don't believe, have one. E.G. Bowman has been around, as I mentioned, almost 100 years, and we can't even get to bid on the opportunities that the expenses, many of the presenters, speakers have made today. We believe that our products that we offer can assist in any plan to restructure the city-state off-track betting. The capitalization and working capital financing, these things that we take a look at, and we look at them very seriously to see how the operation can be better served for the state. We currently do business with many of the state agencies, but for some reason or other, we have not been able to, I would say, crack or be given an opportunity as a service provider. So the purpose of my visit today, obviously, is to ask your committee to look at making sure that in any legislation that would deal with the restructuring of any of the entities that would include a minority participation very strongly.
We said you can bid. Explain it.
What I mean by that is you can't even find out who is the risk manager in the agency. That's the individual who handles the procurement of the insurance programs. And when we do get involved, contact them, they say, well, it's the bid notification was out 6 months ago in the contract reporter or the city record or the congressional records. But here in New York State, the risk manager usually have some reason to not allow our organization to receive the bid notification of the particular coverage that is required for that that entity, whether it's OTB, the associations. We can't even get to the right person. I was glad to see that certain representatives here today that obviously we would be able to receive the bid notifications, be able to review them, and submit a proposal. Now, the chairman, the last speaker of TV, speaking in terms of a plan, we have the capacity and the professionalism to review a business plan and offer suggestions that would work in some cases. If ignored, then obviously they just are put to the wayside. So when I talk in terms of bid opportunities, we're asking for the opportunity to receive the bid notification in a reasonable time so that we prepare a proposal that would help them to protect their assets.
And I think that's a reasonable request. And the fortunate for us, we have the president of OTB here. And what I'm going to suggest is that as we conclude these hearings, is for you to have a conversation with Mr. Casey. And please communicate with my office, but I'm sure he's more than willing to make sure that you receive the necessary bid information and get to notice in time. You know, no one can guarantee a particular procurement of a contract, but at a minimum, all bids should be looked at and should be examined, and I'm sure that you can have a conversation with him now, and you could please keep my office informed.
Absolutely.
Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank everyone for attending.